Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the 16th scientific session, which deals with diabetes and female disorders, new breakthroughs. I'm Georgiana Gordon-Strawn, and I will be taking you through these presentations. I'm going to start by just explaining the rules of this session. Each presenter has about half an hour, and so what we will do is at the end of each presentation, we will break for just two questions. So I would like you to cooperate with me by just keeping your questions short and to the point. So to your benefit, the presenters have assured me that they will not go on for half an hour each. I know that we are trying to leave, so I'll thank them in advance for being brief. Our first presenter will speak to us about pregnancy in diabetes. As you may be aware, the maternal mortality ratio for Jamaica is about 90 per 100,000 live births, and the leading cause of maternal deaths in Jamaica is for chronic non-communicable diseases. Among these, sickle cell disease and hypertension are some of the leading causes, along with diabetes. So it is indeed fitting that Dr. Leslie Samuels should speak to us on this topic. Dr. Samuels graduated from medical school, University of the West Indies, in 1999, and completed his postgraduate training in obstetrics and gynecology in 2006. He has been assigned since then to the high-risk antenatal firm of the UHWI, where he serves as a consultant OBGYN. He was a founding consultant in the ultra-high-risk antenatal clinic at that same institution, which was set up with an aim to address the obstetric complications which most often lead to maternal mortality. He sits, along with Dr. Rattray, as the UHWI representatives of the Government of Jamaica's Maternal Mortality Review Committee. He's also an associate lecturer, and he has published in both national, local, and international journals. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Leslie Samuels.
Good afternoon, everybody. All right, great. We're good to go. All right, good afternoon again. So as Dr. Strawn indicated, I'm going to be presenting pregnancy complicated by diabetes, just a brief overview of what the pathology is like, what our concerns are, and how we approach it in 2018. So as I'm sure you've heard about a million times in the last 2 days, diabetes is a persistent state of hyperglycemia, which is generally caused by either an absolute or relative lack of insulin and or its activity. We have type 1, which is usually autoimmune from a pathological perspective, type 2, which is generally due to insulin resistance, and of course, mature onset diabetes in the young, otherwise known as monogenic diabetes, which is due to an autosomal dominant trait, which is, of course, transmitted from one's parents. Now, again, brief background with the pathophysiology. Reduced insulin leads to hyperglycemia, and of course, hyperglycemia can cause several problems, short-term, medium, and long-term. In the short-term, you get an osmotic diuresis, you get polyuria as one of the classical symptoms of diabetes, and persistent polyuria can lead to intravascular depletion. Of greater significance, though, is the fact that insulin has both anabolic and anti-catabolic activities. And once you don't have enough insulin or its activity, you lose the anti-catabolic activities and you start to break down fat. You generate free fatty acids, and during the metabolism of these free fatty acids, you generate other acids such as lactate, formate, and beta-hydroxybutyrate. the sum total of more acid production in a smaller circulating volume can push the person into developing a significant metabolic acidosis, and that is, in fact, part of the pathophys of diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, the other thing that a persistent hyperglycemia does is that you get this non-enzymatic-based attachment of glucose onto other chemical moieties, mostly proteins, and so we get glycation products. Now, initially when this occurs, it's reversible, so you can go in and out of the equation in both directions, but then these in-between moieties can now further go and attach to other proteins and create either cross-linking or just addox, and we refer to these as advanced glycated end products. Glycated hemoglobin is one such example, and that was actually the first glycated end product that was recognized. This is just a diagrammatic representation of that. Sugar is a very active moiety. You have the COOH on one end. All proteins have an amine, NH2, and a COOH carboxyl on the other end. So it's logical that they would, you know, react if they're left together long enough. Now, the important thing with respect to advanced glycation end products is that they literally and figuratively stress the body out. They can act directly through the formation of reactive oxygen species, peroxide, superoxide, hydroxyl, and so on. But they also may act through their receptor. So advanced glycosylated end products, we just summarize as AGE. So the receptor for these is called RAGE, R-A-G-E. RAGE binding promotes numerous signal pathways which culminate in activation of transcription factors, and these now go on to code for the production of several pro-inflammatory mediators. Advanced glycated end products generally form with proteins containing lysine, and the characteristic of this in the body is collagen. Furthermore, the receptors are expressed by keratinocytes, fibroblasts, and dendritic cells, all of which are found in skin, and furthermore expressed in endothelial cells and in lymphocytes. So this now gives us the basis for a systemic vascular inflammatory response. Lastly, when you activate the receptor for advanced glycated end products, the factors that are transcribed also cause upregulation of the receptor themselves, and so it sets up this potential positive feedback pathway. So, in a nutshell, insulin absence or resistance leads to hyperglycemia, and hyperglycemia has several consequences. In the short to medium term, you have metabolic abnormalities, but in the long term, you have a pro-inflammatory state which disproportionately affects blood vessels at the endothelial, basement membrane, and even the smooth muscle layers. And this, of course, is one of the reasons why diabetes can wreak such havoc systemically. All right, shift gears now. Let me talk about pregnancy. The placenta, in the context of pregnancy, obviously, is a major endocrine organ. There's very little that the placenta cannot synthesize. Now, unfortunately, many of the hormones made by the placenta are anti-insulinemic, and the top three of these would be human placenta, lactogen, prolactin, and cortisol. Progesterone is also made by the placenta in great quantities, and whereas progesterone is not a diabetogenic hormone per se, it does have a direct stimulatory effect on the appetite center in the brain. So, when we have our pregnant girls, what we have is a situation where their caloric intake is increased, and we have an overall net decrease action of insulin. In the normal woman, what happens is that your fasting blood glucose might go from 4 to 5, which is still in the normal range, and your 2 hours might go from 6.5 to 7.5, which is still in the normal range. However, if I were a girl with my advanced BMI, or if my parents were both diabetic and so on and so forth, that could tip me over into a state of persistent hyperglycemia, in which case we diagnose now gestational diabetes. Because gestational diabetes is usually caused by the anti-insulinemic hormones of pregnancy, we generally see it taking clinical effect in the second half of pregnancy. Having said that, the definition states diagnosed for the first time in pregnancy. So there's a little bit of a mix-up there. Now, relevance. As of 2015, there are an estimated 60 million women in reproductive age group between 18 and 44 who are already diabetic. And this number is expected to increase, or by double actually, by 2030, so another 12 years' time. Now, diabetes has numerous fetal-maternal morbidities associated with it, and what has also been increased, well, interesting, is that we've had a shift in the proportion of diabetics that we're seeing. 10, 15, 20 years ago, most diabetics in pregnancy were the younger girls with type 1. Now what we're seeing is we're seeing the less younger girls with type 2 as a consequence of putting off fertility for careers and so on and so forth. So the complications that diabetes can wreak are numerous. I've summarized some of them here. If you achieve pregnancy, there's a greater risk of losing it, spontaneous abortion. And if the pregnancy does continue and you're uncontrolled, there's a greater rate in pre-gestational diabetes of congenital defects. Again, for pre-gestational diabetes, there's a rate which is increased above normal for intrauterine growth restriction, whereas any diabetes in pregnancy with hyperglycemia and hyperinsulinemia could result also in macrosomia, which is on a diametrically opposite end of the spectrum. Things like polyhydramnios are more common, preeclampsia is more common, and as a consequence of all these morbidities, preterm birth is more common in the diabetic than it is in the average patient. Now, I've put a small list here of some of the neonatal complications that can occur. Hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia. Other way, you can produce too much bilirubin and you can get even day one jaundice, which is always pathological. And babies of uncontrolled diabetic mothers have an increased predisposition for hypoxic injury, either directly because of birth trauma or as a consequence of the various metabolic derangements that occur during the course of the pregnancy. So very quickly, I just want to run through some of these complications. That's what I'm supposed to be talking about today. As we had led up to earlier, hyperglycemia and advanced glycated end products can both induce oxidative stress. And oxidative stress in the body activates cellular stress signaling that eventually can lead, in the context of pregnancy, to the dysregulation of gene expression in the embryo and excess apoptosis in target organs. Now, the cardiovascular system is one of the first systems to be generated around 5 weeks after conception. Your central nervous system is right behind at about 38, maybe 40 days. And so the disproportionately high number of congenital anomalies associated with diabetes occur in the cardiovascular and the central nervous system. But really and truly, it can affect any organ. Now, this table is just to represent the context of when a woman becomes pregnant in the context of diabetes. If her HbA1c is absolutely normal, 6% or less, she already has a chance, about 3%, of having a baby with a congenital anomaly. Now, let's be clear. This is total congenital anomalies. So a little birthmark, a little extra digit, as well as the major ones that we think about, ventricular septal defects and proximal and distal neural tube defects. But as the HbA1c value increases linearly, 6, 7, 8, 9, the rate of congenital anomalies increases exponentially. So we start off with a basal rate of 2, which is just slightly above the 1.5 for the general population. But when the A1C reaches 11, you have a chance of 20% likelihood that the baby is going to be affected. So it's a pretty big deal. Now, pre-gestational diabetes causes up to a 9-fold increase in birth defects compared to the rate seen in non-diabetics. And the problem is that the time where these defects occur is very, very early in the pregnancy. Let's be clear, we date a pregnancy around the last menstrual period when a woman is not actually pregnant. Conception generally occurs 2 weeks later, and we start counting at that point in time. It means that by the time a woman misses her period, she's technically already 4 weeks pregnant. The cardiovascular system and the neural, well, central nervous system generally form between 4 and 5 weeks. So by the time the girl misses her period, wait 3 days to make sure, wait another day to buy the pregnancy test, you know, build up herself and do the pregnancy test, bald for 2 days or happy for 2 days or whatever. By the time she book an appointment to see her gynecologist at 6 weeks, the horse gone through the gate. All right? So we're not sure about how far down we can take that rate, but we'll do a try. All right, next complication, growth restriction. Growth restriction is almost unique for pre-gestational diabetes because it is a direct consequence of a vasculopathy in the mother, and it takes quite a long time for vasculopathy to develop. Now, the risk of growth restriction correlates positively with the duration of diabetes, and the highest rates are reported in women who are known to have diabetic nephropathy, so it's indicative of extensive systemic vasculopathy. Histological findings in the placenta, you see things like distal villus hypoplasia, distal villus immaturity, and dysmorphic villi. And all of this is saying that the placenta at its functional level is not made properly. Consequently, there is a lower surface area for respiratory exchange to take place, and you end up with a situation of placental insufficiency. Not enough food and oxygen leads to a smaller baby. On the opposite extreme, we have macrosomia. No. Classically, we were taught that if mom is hyperglycemic, the baby going to be hyperglycemic. There's nothing wrong with the baby's pancreas, and therefore the baby becomes hyperinsulinemic. We know that both insulin and insulin-like growth factor behave as growth factors for the fetus, and therefore increased expression of these cytokines was positively associated with weight and thought to be causative of fetal macrosomia. Now, what we have further elucidated is that the control of insulin and insulin-like growth factor is partially modulated by the insulin and insulin-like growth factor binding proteins. Say that five times really, really fast. And we have known, well, we've found out that diabetic women actually show up to a threefold increase in proteolytic degradation of the binding proteins. This, of course, leads to an increased free fraction, and this, as we said, correlates with birth weight. So it's not just the high blood sugars, it's the entire endocrine pathology that goes on in the diabetes. Preeclampsia. Preeclampsia classically was diagnosed with hypertension, proteinuria, and edema. These days, we don't use edema for the diagnostic criteria anymore. But what I want to say about preeclampsia is it is based on the pathology of maternal endothelial damage and dysfunction. The etiology is not quite clear. We're not exactly sure what goes wrong to lead up to it. But we know that it's as a consequence of abnormal trophoblastic invasion when the placenta is being made. Now, the reason I took the first six or so slides to go through that whole advanced glycated end products was to point out that diabetes puts you in a place where you have vascular inflammation. Pregnancy and the generation of a placenta is literally making a hemochorionic organ. It's an organ almost entirely composed of blood vessels of either maternal or fetal origin. And so diabetes is very, very closely intertwined in the pathology of preeclampsia. As a consequence, if you are a pre-gestational diabetic, you have almost a four-time increased chance of developing preeclampsia in pregnancy as a non-diabetic. So the rate generally is between 5% and 7%. In diabetics is between 12 and as high as 20%. If you are just a gestational diabetic, so you've only had it for 2 or 3 months, the rate is still increased, but only by about 50% with an odds ratio of 1.5. Now, where it gets interesting is where you have a diabetic who had come into the pregnancy with some sort of systemic complication, so nephropathy or so on, because of course preeclampsia can also affect almost any organ system. And so you might find that you have consequences of the pregnancy on other aspects of the woman's life aside from her blood sugar. Generally speaking, if a woman comes into pregnancy with nephropathy, but she has minimal albuminuria and a normal creatinine clearance, the pregnancy will not cause any permanent damage. You might find a little dip that occurs during the course of it, but by 6 weeks after she's had the baby, she's back to her normal. The problem now is if you come into pregnancy with significant albuminuria or a decreased creatinine clearance, because in that case, the pregnancy will cause a decreased renal function, but then you have the baby and you're stuck where you are. It becomes a permanent change. Last but not least, we'll speak about preterm birth. Now, this can be caused because of diabetes directly or because something indirectly associated. So ketoacidosis, growth restriction, and oligohydramnios, secondary to placental insufficiency, non-reassuring fetal status, preeclampsia, and the list goes on and on and on. Now, this is relevant because preterm birth is the leading cause of neonatal morbidity and mortality worldwide. In the context of diabetes, even a term baby can suffer like a preterm baby, because even though the babies are nice and big and fluffy, their development on a cellular and tissue level lags behind. So if a term baby can have respiratory distress syndrome, you can imagine that a preterm baby is going to suffer even more than expected. So we're at the beach, we're going to stop with the doom and gloom, and we're going to talk about some management strategies. How can we try and prevent some of these complications from occurring? So obviously, the best outcome will be achieved if we can get to these young ladies before they become pregnant. We want to achieve euglycemia by almost any means possible, and we want to maintain that euglycemia for ideally about 3 to 6 months before they're going to get pregnant, so that everything is normal. Their actual blood sugar right now, as well as their HbA1c, meaning that they've been normal for a quarter of a year. Now, for the patients who are on diet alone, they can stay until they get pregnant. If they're on metformin or if they're on insulin, those are fine because those are perfectly safe in pregnancy. We aim to control comorbidities. So for the hypertensive patient or the patient with renal disease, we want to make sure that we get the pressure under control and we get their renal function as good as it's going to get. It's very, very important that we try and use medications which are compatible with pregnancy. So Aldomet, alpha-methyl-DOPA, nifedipine, labetalol, hydralazine, all these are fantastic, they're perfectly safe, and they're very, very effective. ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers and statins, where you have a corresponding hypercholesterolemia, are absolutely contraindicated. They are category X. They will cause teratogenesis, and we don't want them with our pregnant girls for about a month before conception even takes place. All right. Yeah, seriously. Okay. Now, as we were saying, best outcomes will be achieved if the patient is optimized prior to becoming pregnant. And so, hold on, did I go backwards? Yes, I did. Oops, sorry. Other way. Initial investigations. Usual antenatal screen. Check the blood count, check the blood type, check to make sure she doesn't have any sickle cell and her serology, HIV and VDRL, according to our Millennium Development Goals. We check the glycated hemoglobin levels for the reasons previously discussed, and with the midstream urine, because diabetics are more prone to having asymptomatic bacteria, which can go on to cystitis, which can go on to pyelonephritis and further compromise them. As far as renal performance is concerned, you can have spot albumin creatinine ratio or a full 24-hour collection for protein and creatinine clearance, doesn't matter. And of course, we want a dating ultrasound. So if they're small for gestational age or large for gestational age, we don't worry because we know precisely how old the baby is. For the type 1 diabetics pre-gestational, we also do thyroid studies because up to 40% of type 1 diabetics in the context of pregnancy have some element of thyroid dysfunction. If you've had previous cardiac history or symptoms with an ECG to rule out ischemic change or damage. And last but not least, we want a detailed retinal assessment because whatever extent of retinopathy we see will be suggestive of the extent of systemic vasculopathy. We start all our diabetics on low-dose aspirin at the first possible time. The books will tell us by the 12th week, so entering into the second trimester. But if you think about it, the placenta is made in the first trimester mostly. So the earlier you can start, the better off. The patients will be. Folic acid supplementation is a necessary thing for pregnancy in general and in the context of diabetes in particular, because you want to know to drop that incidence of neural tube defects as low as you possibly can. The range in the literature ranges between 1 milligrams and 5 milligrams, but it's a water-soluble vitamin. The patients can't get toxic, so it doesn't really matter. They'll take what they need and pee out the rest. Aneuploidy screening does not change in pregnancy with diabetes because diabetes does not affect aneuploidy. So normal ultrasound for nuchal translucency at around 11 to 14 weeks, quad screen at 18, and your anomaly scan at 20. The only adjunct here is that if you're looking for cardiac defects, you may want that second ultrasound at about 24 weeks because the baby is bigger, the heart is bigger, and your pickup rate will be a little bit higher. The patient plays an active role in her well-being. So home self-monitoring is absolutely crucial. We want at least 2 or 3 complete profiles per week for the entire pregnancy. We're aiming for very, very tight control. We want our fastings below 6 and our postprandials always to be below 8. If the patient on oral meds, you may want to change her to insulin depending on how her control has been. But like I said, metformin is safe. And if insulin is necessary, we generally favor a mixed split regime using both soluble and NPH insulin given twice a day. For fetal assessment in the third trimester, the mothers will do kick charts, and we of course have the options for doing non-stress testing or ultrasounds for both biometrics, you know how big the baby is, and biophysical profiles, which can pick up evidence of hypoxia. For the well-controlled diabetic patient, she can stick to the same schedule as a non-diabetic pregnant patient. For the higher risk ones who have given them more trouble or had a higher glycated HB or whatever, you might want to start seeing them more often earlier in the pregnancy leading up to delivery. Now, delivering a diabetic ideally would be between 38 and 39 weeks, so full term. If you have a very well-controlled, very well-disciplined girl, she can go up to her due date. But under no circumstances do I allow diabetics to go post-dates because then they get cumulative addition of the morbidities associated with them. We do vaginal delivery unless a cesarean section is indicated or unless a vaginal delivery is contraindicated. And we must have skilled birth attendants present at time of delivery because things like shoulder dystocia are much, much more common in diabetes than they are in a non-diabetic population. Pediatricians also have to be there so that can help us deal with all those lists of things I listed earlier. Once a woman has the baby, most things are as usual. We encourage breastfeeding, and if they were gestational diabetics, then we stop their medications because the pregnancy is now gone. Pre-gestational diabetics tend to put them back on whatever regime they were on before because in contrast to the hypertensive medications, most of these diabetic medications taken orally are compatible with breastfeeding and lactation. Likewise, all contraceptive forms are generally accepted in the context of diabetes, but if your patient has evidence of vasculopathy, then we prefer if we don't use something containing estrogen, like the combined oral contraceptive pill, because that can also potentially have a cumulative effect. Last two slides. This is just to say that the influence of pre and gestational diabetes in pregnancy is not just for the mother. We have always known that there is a genetic predisposition towards diabetes, but what we're now realizing is that the offspring of diabetics, when they become adults, they inherit, and no, I shouldn't say inherit, they are more at risk for a variety of endocrinopathies and cardioendocrine pathologies that don't necessarily follow a strict genetic transmission course. So it seems like intrauterine programming as a consequence of the maternal hyperglycemia plays a part in that, and we will of course need more time to see how that plays out for future. So in conclusion, yes, okay. Pregnancies complicated by diabetes have a higher rate of many adverse outcomes. That's indisputable. What we need to focus on, though, and I find life as an obstetrician nice and simple. A woman comes to you pregnant, she wants to go home with her baby. So I find it useful. When you look at the studies, they speak about adverse outcomes, admission to nursery, cesarean section, yada, yada, yada. What we really want to know is, how many of these women go home with their baby? And those rates have increased wonderfully in the last quarter century or so. We're now having over 90% take-home baby rate compared to a 98 or 99% for the non-diabetic patient. So we're getting closer. So at the end of the day, whereas we know that diabetics are high-risk categories in pregnancy, the corner is not completely dark. We know now that a well-controlled diabetic can be expected to have a reasonably favorable outcome in the long term, and so we welcome them, one and all. And that takes us to the end. Thank you.
Thank you, Leslie. The floor is open for two questions.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Sir, that was excellent.
Thank you.
Can you comment on the timing of doing the glucose profile in a pregnant lady with known or unknown diabetes?
Timing.
When is the best time? 12 weeks, 18 weeks, 22 weeks?
For glucose profile?
For glucose profile.
No, ma'am. 2 or 3 times a week, every week, for the 38 weeks of the pregnancy.
Starting from
when they have a positive pregnancy test.
Suppose it's non-diabetic.
Oh, well, if they're normal and then they acquire, so they get gestational diabetes, then we usually go like twice a week from the time of diagnosis until delivery.
So when is the first time I should do for my patients? 20 weeks.
Screening. Oh, right. So we screen for gestational diabetes between 24 and 28 weeks.
Thank you, sir.
Sullivan's test.
That's one. Second one. Sir, about the blood tests, other than what you have shown, would you like to do ALT, AST?
All right. The question basically is liver function testing in the context of diabetes in pregnancy, ALT, AST, and so on. We don't need them for the pregnancy directly, but they may become relevant depending on what medication the patient is on and what comorbidities they have. The comorbidities now are the ones they come into pregnancy with, as well as the ones that they can develop as a consequence of the pregnancy. So we spoke about preeclampsia. Preeclampsia notoriously affects the liver. So if the woman does become hypertensive, which she's want to do at about 20%, then yes, we'll be following those as a big picture kind of management for the diabetic patient.
In addition to PET, where nowadays the American College diagnostic criteria, they don't include all the three, like edema, hypertension, albuminuria.
We don't use edema anymore.
Not required, as you said it nicely.
Yes.
In addition to PET, suppose the lady has fatty liver, how would you know?
All right. Acute fatty liver of pregnancy takes us to a different level altogether. So we have to be clear now. A diabetic, especially if she's obese, especially if she has dyslipidemia, okay, can have a source of fatty liver. So I probably have a source of fatty liver, right? But we make a distinction. We have an entity called acute fatty liver of pregnancy. Yeah. It is one of the most deadly things out there. If you get a pregnant girl in her third trimester and she becomes jaundiced, she have AFLP until proven otherwise. First thing you do is take the baby immediately, if not before.
What about non-acute?
And the next thing is, one second, and the next thing is supportive for coagulopathies, which is the next thing to follow. So we just have to, you know, kind of define our terms very, very
agreed,
carefully.
What about non-acute fatty liver?
Non-acute is benign. We leave it alone.
Fatty liver?
No, non-acute fatty liver is benign, so we leave it alone. Like I said, I could have, I probably have non-acute fatty liver, not pregnancy.
We can't leave it.
I'm just saying. The belly is there, but it's not a baby. Sorry. What?
Point is taken. But fatty liver is dangerous, sir.
Yes.
We'll talk.
Okay.
Thank you. We have one question from Professor Tolery, forgive me. Marshall.
So one question, because it comes up a lot of times, the use of analog insulins and more complicated regimens, and I don't know if generally obstetricians have any concerns about the use of these in pregnancy.
No. Insulin is a beautiful molecule because it's very highly charged, and therefore it does not cross the placenta at all. It is therefore the ideal, the gold standard of treatment for diabetes, because you can mix and match any way you want to achieve euglycemia, and the baby is protected. Fabulous.
Thank you, Dr. Samuels, on behalf of the audience. We're going to move swiftly along to Dr. Jordan Hardie. Now, as a son of an OBGYN and a midwife, one might surmise that Dr. Hardie had little choice in what his career path would be. Dr. Hardie followed his father's footsteps and graduated with a doctorate of medicine in obstetrics and gynecology from the University of the West Indies in 2014. He likes to distinguish himself from his father by saying that, as a younger Hardie, I am more technologically advanced. His special interests include high-risk obstetrics and medical education, and he currently practices at Contemporary Medical Affiliates Limited. When not seeing patients, he's an avid football fan. So you know this year is a very special year for him because we have World Cup football in Russia. Unfortunately, he has advised me that he will not be able to attend because he has a new member in his family. Congrats, Dr. Hardie. Please welcome Dr. Hardie as he presents to us on diabetes, mellitus, and vaginitis.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd just like to say good afternoon, Madam Chair, and all of our esteemed guests. And I'd also like to thank the organizers for inviting me. So I have been placed between two absolute titans of the field. So Dr. Samuel started the race, and I must say he did fantastic. I have the short corner, and Professor Boyne will carry us home. Diabetes, mellitus, and vaginitis. So why is the gynecologist up here speaking to you about vaginitis? Why did they even invite him? So what we have found, or what Wilkes et al. Eloquently found in the Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Survey, diabetes is increasing in our population. And of concern to all of us, they found that more women are being diagnosed with diabetes than men. Very concerning. So briefly, I will speak about the anatomy of the vagina, just briefly. A short definition on diabetes, what is vaginitis, and of course how we approach it. So a very short definition on diabetes, I'm sure you're tired of hearing it now. Diabetes mellitus is a group of metabolic diseases characterized by hyperglycemia resulting from defects in insulin secretion, insulin action, or both. So welcome to the X-rated part of the program. What is the vagina? Where is the vagina? So for those who are not quite sure, I will provide a little map and the vaginal environment. So what is the vagina? So it is a fibromuscular tube quite frequently used for copulation. It extends... Which one is the pointer? Yes?
Yeah,
yes. So it extends from the perineum through the pelvic floor into the pelvic cavity. Anteriorly, it's related to the base of the bladder. Posteriorly, it is related to the rectum. Inferiorly, it opens into the vestibule of the perineum, and of course, the cervix projects into the vagina. So this gentleman here, Mr. Albert Dodelin, is a German gynecologist. He discovered that the normal vaginal microbiota consists primarily of lactobacillus. Why is this important? Well, in this time of state of emergencies, we have the normal flora defense system. So the lactobacillus produces lactic acid, which reduces the vaginal pH to 4.5. It also produces hydrogen peroxide, which is antagonistic to some microbes by direct interaction, and production of bacteriocins, which are antimicrobial peptides, which work synergistically with lactobacilli to eradicate bacteria. What is a vaginitis? So the term is used to encompass infections or inflammatory conditions of the vagina. Most common infectious causes of the vagina of vaginitis include vaginal candidiasis, which I will speak more of, bacterial vaginosis, and trichomoniasis. Other non-infectious causes may include a foreign body, vaginal atrophy in our postmenopausal patient, irritants, so for those patients who douche, and dermatosis. So is there really a connection? The most common vaginitis seen with patients who have diabetes mellitus is candida albicans, or vaginal candidiasis. So in a UK primary care study where they looked at genital tract infections, they found that the patients with type 2 diabetes had a significantly increased risk of developing a vaginitis. So how exactly does this happen? Font is a little small, but I will go through it. So how does diabetes mellitus increase the patient's risk of developing a vaginal candidiasis? So what we believe is that the hyperglycemia induces the candida organism to produce a protein which is similar in structure and function to the complement receptor CD11B, CD18, which is found on phagocytes. This protein, one, it helps to mediate the adhesion of the candida to the vaginal mucosa, so it makes it more adherent to the vaginal mucosa. It also inhibits the phagocytosis of candida, impairing the host defense. And lastly, hyperglycemia provides an environment conducive to the replication of candida, as candida has been found to be in the normal flora of about 20% of patients. So how do these patients present? The patient may present with a history of a vaginal discharge, which they may describe as curdy or clumpy, itching, burning, or dyspareunia. On examination, the vulva may be hyperemic. You may notice excoriations, and they may have a cottage cheese appearing vaginal discharge. So what investigations? So after clinical history and examinations, most clinicians will have a strong suspicion that this patient has vaginal candidiasis. However, we do advise that patients should have some confirmatory investigations because they may have a mixed vaginosis as well, which can be a bit of a challenge. So investigations available are the vaginal pH testing, direct microscopy, and direct culture. So vaginal pH testing includes placing a strip of pH paper in the vagina, and the pH associated with vaginal candidiasis is approximately 4 to 4.5 in comparison to bacterial vaginosis, which will give you a pH of greater than 4.5, and trichomoniasis, which will give you a pH of greater than 6. If you decide to do further testing, you can do direct microscopy. And this entails taking a vaginal discharge, smearing it on a slide, and adding 10% potassium hydroxide. This potassium hydroxide helps to destroy cellular elements in the vaginal discharge. The direct microscopy will demonstrate hyphae, pseudohyphae, or buds of the Candida albicans species present. Direct microscopy may also visualize clue cells if bacterial vaginosis is present, and spirochetes in the case of trichomoniasis if the patient has a mixed vaginosis. Patients with a normal pH test and an inconclusive direct microscopy, and the clinician still suspects that they have vaginal candidiasis, should have culture taken. So treatment of candidiasis, vaginal candidiasis, is dependent on which if the patient has a complicated course or an uncomplicated course. As we can see from my table, diabetes makes the patient complicated. So the impact of diabetes mellitus on treatment. Patients with uncontrolled diabetes may not respond to therapy until their diabetes is controlled. They may have a prolonged treatment course. They may require multiple treatment courses, and they may develop resistance. So what are the goals of treatment? Control of the hyperglycemia. So quite frequently, many women are diagnosed with diabetes after presenting to their gynecologist with recurrent vaginal candidiasis. So a multidisciplinary approach is recommended: referral to an endocrinologist or a diabetologist, referral to a dietitian, and referral to a diabetic educator. And of course, where I come in, treat the fungal infection. So treatment options: good and tested fluconazole 150 milligrams orally. This may be subsequently followed by another course of fluconazole 3 days following the initial course. If, however, the patient does not respond, a course of fluconazole once a week for 6 months can be instituted. Patients, however, who have fluconazole-resistant Candida albicans or are infected with a non-albicans form of Candida may be treated with itraconazole 100 mg twice daily for 3 days, ketoconazole 100 mg once daily for 5 days. Of course, if you're using the oral component, these patients should have their liver function test done. And boric acid 600 mg intravaginally for 2 weeks. So what is the long-term outlook? Patients with adequate glycemic control and fungal eradication can expect to make a full recovery. Prevention: adequate glycemic control. This is, I cannot stress this anymore, which is why we definitely recommend the multidisciplinary approach and referring to our good friends, the physicians. Good hygienic practices. So in summary, the incidence of diabetes is increasing in the West Indian population, more so women than men. Vaginal candidiasis is the most common vaginitis associated with diabetes mellitus. Hyperglycemia impacts the host immune system, reducing the host ability to eradicate the candida and providing a suitable environment for growth. Treatment is multidisciplinary and is targeted at glycemic control and fungal eradication, and our patients can expect to make a full recovery.
You're going to have to exercise the chair's authority. How dare you put St. George's without putting up all the other schools? Anyway, we can have a fight about that later on. Jordan, thank you so much for your presentation. And as with Leslie's presentation, we will allow for 2 questions. Although I know his presentation was extremely clear, and I'm quite sure there are no... Okay, so we have 1 question.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Sir, that was good presentation. Very good.
Thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. Can you comment on the treatment of the partner while you're treating the patient?
So for treatment of the partner is dependent. Well, first you need to invite the partner and examine the partner. Most men are not at significant risk for balanitis. However, if the patient is uncircumcised, their risk of having a balanitis is significantly increased. And if the male patient is diabetic, that risk is even more increased.
True.
So it's dependent on the history and examination. So you need to invite the male partner and examine the patient before prescribing medication.
And even without, if he's non-diabetic also, once the female partner is being treated, it's always nice to treat the partner even without his coming for checkup. Generally, I send him a prescription, and I send him an invitation to come. Some of them don't come, nearly half of my patients, they just don't come.
Yes.
I call them and I request, and then they do come. But because treating the patient without the partner being treated sometimes gives problems, it just keeps coming back.
That is true.
Thank you, sir.
Very good presentation. Could you give me the best treatment for diabetes, for candida vaginitis in pregnancy? The best form of treatment?
Best form of treatment, wow. So treatment for vaginal candidiasis with a patient who is diabetic and pregnant. First things first, control the sugar. It is harmful to mother, a fetus, and of course the vaginal candidiasis. We generally in pregnancy do not use oral medication, we tend to use intravaginal medication. So intravaginal itraconazole is quite common. I see our good friends here, the drug reps are here. But we generally use intravaginal canistin as initial treatment. And most patients respond once you control the blood glucose in pregnancy. But treatment is generally intravaginally. Oral medication is contraindicated to the pregnant patient.
Dr. Hardie, I know you're dealing with diabetes and vaginitis, candidiasis, but in general practice, women come into your office and they have a yeast infection.
Yes.
They label a vaginal discharge as a yeast infection. And many times, it's not only yeast, as you pointed out, but where do we go with the DNA testing to differentiate the different types of vaginal discharge? I know this is not in diabetes, but I'm just asking.
Okay, all right. So we are still in STI month. So if memory serves me correctly, Carigen is offering a special. I hope they give me a little stipend for that ad.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
for DNA testing, it is not usual that we request DNA testing for all vaginal discharges. So investigating the patient with a mixed vaginosis. Generally, history and clinical examination are very important. If you believe that this mixed vaginosis is a sexually transmitted infection, then definitely I do recommend the DNA testing, because one, it offers direct diagnosis. Two, it will pick up things that you may have not seen. Because quite frequently, if you see a mixed vaginosis, the discharge can be a little difficult to delineate. So when you get the report, it will tell you directly what is there. We do recommend symptomatic treatment as per the Ministry of Health. And of course, counseling of the patient if you suspect that the treatment, if the vaginal discharge is secondary to a sexually transmitted infection. If you believe it is bacterial vaginosis, then you can just counsel the patient about hygiene practices and treat accordingly.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Hardie. And I thank him especially for keeping it short and sweet. Our next presenter is Professor Michael Boyne. He was asked earlier by one of his colleagues, how did an endocrinologist end up in a panel such as this? And I think his response was, well, endocrinology is everything, you know, it does everything, we're everywhere. So Michael Boyne is a professor of endocrinology and metabolism at the Department of Medicine and the Caribbean Institute for Health Research at the University of the West Indies. He's also an honorary consultant at the University Hospital of the West Indies. He has a BSc in biochemistry and did his medical degree at the University of the West Indies. After his residency in internal medicine at the University of Virginia, he completed a 3-year fellowship in endocrinology, diabetes, and metabolism at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. He was board certified in internal medicine and endocrinology, diabetes, and metabolism. He's a fellow of the Royal Colleges of Physicians of Canada, Edinburgh, and London. He has authored and co-authored several papers, maybe about 60, maybe more, along with several book chapters. His research interests include the roles of factors in early life, such as nutrition, in the development of the metabolic syndrome. He's a member of several associations, including the Endocrine Society, Development Origins of Health and Disease, and the Caribbean Endocrine Association. He is currently the president of the Association of Consultant Physicians of Jamaica. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Michael Boyne.
Thank you, Georgiana, although you don't listen to instructions because I said don't read out the CV, but that's quite fine. All forgiven. Glad to be here again to talk about gestational diabetes on a different hat. I don't know about carrying the ball home, or sorry, carrying the last leg, but I do recognize that I'm here to tell you that sugar and water do not mix, especially when it's placental water. And I'm going to really just follow on from what Leslie has done, because he's painted it very, very well, and I'm just going to put some of my perspectives as well as it also leads on to the aspects of gestational diabetes and afterwards. And I have no disclosures to declare. Now, Elliot Joslin, regarded as the father of endocrinology, quoted a case of gestational diabetes, one of the first cases, back in 1897 in his textbook. Well, his textbook was 1917, but he quoted this case from 1897, which, as you can read, the pregnancy resulted in a dead baby. They didn't go home as was said before. However, the diabetes returned in 9 years and was moderate to severe. And it was thought that it could have been prevented. A matter of fact, O'Sullivan, where we get the O'Sullivan's test in 1964, why they proposed this was more a formal recognition of the mother's increased risk of future diabetes. So I want to also speak a little bit about how people develop diabetes later on. Now, this graph is, although it looks like a little lean on the screen there, is really just to remind you of the deathly approach of diabetes to the development of infant mortality. And as the years go by with better control, you can see that we can get that infant mortality rate all the way down. So it makes a big difference. And as was said before, diabetes does complicate pregnancies, whether pre-existing diabetes or gestational diabetes. We heard about perinatal mortality, hypertensive complications, as well as the neonatal complications, which have already been described. Now, that is based on, and you know, I'm wearing my biochemistry hat, Georgiana, right? Leslie, you did biochemistry before, didn't you? You speak like a biochemist, though, so that's good. But this is based on the sort of development of the child, that especially that macrosomic child, is based on what we call the Pedersen hypothesis, because Pedersen, in 1952, published how perhaps maternal hyperglycemia leads to fetal hyperglycemia, which then stimulates the pancreas that you have, fetal hyperinsulinemia, and that, of course, now is a growth-promoting effect, as we heard before. But it's slightly modified also that if you have insulin from the mother, which becomes bound to immunoglobulin G, it can also get across to the placenta and also create further macrosomia. So unbound insulin doesn't get across, but bound insulin also does get across and contribute to the hyperglycemia, the fetal hyperinsulinemia. So that's a sort of modified Pedersen hypothesis. But it's further modified because one of the things that we want to point out is not just a glucose effect. We like to focus on glucose when we're speaking about diabetes, but insulin also affects other macronutrients, including fat. And so if you have an insulin-resistant mother who eventually becomes diabetic, she's also having these abnormalities within her fat metabolism, leading into rises of free fatty acids, VLDL, glycerol, all of which contribute to hyperglycemia and growth promotion effects in the fetus. And you can also see from this diagram that when that fetus is becoming larger, they're laying down fat where? In areas where you should not have fat, in visceral components, in the liver, etc. So all this is helping to contribute or program that child for greater problems later on. So we heard a little bit about the congenital abnormalities, which in the diabetes world, we call it diabetic embryopathy. And I put a picture there. Does anybody know who this person is? Well, you should know, because that's Professor Al Reese, right? And Al, as here with UDOP, has done extraordinary amount of works about diabetic embryopathy using a variety of different animal models, tissue culture models, and clinical studies. And so as it has been shown, as your glycemic control worsens, the risk for embryopathy goes up, whether cardiac, musculoskeletal, CNS, genitourinary, and the frequency continues to increase. Now, those of you who are biochemists here, and if Al was here, I don't see Al here, but this part here was for Al. Well, I can put it there for Errol also as a biochemist, because diabetes created a multiplicity of metabolic changes that includes increase of ketone bodies, isoprostanes, the increase of oxidative stress, endoplasmic reticular stress, which caused an unfolding protein response. We won't bore you with those, but all of those are bad news for the fetus. And therefore, it leads to the malformations that we heard before. Well, what data do we have in Jamaica? We don't have enough. Although the Jamaica Perinatal Mortality Survey with Jean Golden and Diana Ashley, et cetera, published on this area. And there is an association of maternal hyperglycemia with an increase in cesarean rates. Also with perinatal mortality, more so though in univariate analysis, not in multivariate analyses, as well as there's an association with macrosomia. There's also some data that the prevalence in one study was about 1.5% of Jamaicans, but it goes up to 12% if there is a family history of gestational diabetes. Now, Leslie told you a bit of before about the individual who already has pre-gestational diabetes, which is getting more and more common because this is old data now. This data is about 20 years old, done by, I won't say senior Wilkes, but less technologically advanced Wilkes, right? Where, as you can see, when you look at the rates of diabetes done in Spanish Town in the 1990s, look at the rates in women of childbearing years, right? 25 to 35, you see about 3%. Then, after it reaches into the mid-30s to the late early 40s, it sees up to 5%. And that's old data. The rates will be higher afterwards. Marshall, we're still waiting for the next phase of the Lifestyle 3 study to give us more. Now, the individual who develops gestational diabetes has one thing in common, two things in common. They're very insulin resistant. And this slide is not to make you feel badly. I just want you to feel glad that I'm not going to take you through it. But it is how these individuals develop insulin resistance. Some of it might be inborn. A lot of it is acquired through lifestyle habits, but excessive nutrition, etc., leads to insulin resistance and a problem with glucose transporters. There's an inflammatory component. There's also an adipocytokine component because there's this little protein called adiponectin that can be low in women who go on to develop gestational diabetes. And adipokines, these cytokines or these molecules coming from fat tissues, have been shown to be abnormal in these women even prior to their development of their gestational diabetes in mid-pregnancy. So adiponectin has been written most about, but quite a few others, including tumor necrosis factor, leptin, etc. And all of these help to lead to insulin resistance and the development of diabetes. But it's not just insulin resistance alone. You have to have, at the same time, a problem with your beta cells. And many of these women who develop gestational diabetes will also have a family history of having diabetes or gestational diabetes. And what that family history is telling you is that in their family, they have beta cells that don't respond very well when you have the stress of insulin resistance of pregnancy. Now, normal pregnancies, a woman will expand her beta cell mass, as seen in the top part of the slide, to compensate for the insulin resistance of pregnancy. And after the baby's been delivered, she will return to her normal beta cell mass. But women who are predisposed to develop gestational diabetes, their beta cell mass does not change. And therefore, they're unable to compensate and they become hyperglycemic. So this slide is just to summarize some of the prior slides that you have problems with lifestyle as a pre-existing risk factor, genetic factors. We're not going to go into PCOS because that's another separate big issue for us to go into. but it will lead to changes in insulin resistance, and if you already have a predisposition to poor beta cell function, you're going to be tipped over into this hyperglycemic state, which will enhance fetal growth and lead to problems. So we know risk factors for the development of gestational diabetes. Some are modifiable and some are not modifiable. But the ones which are modifiable, such as pre-gravid obesity and dietary factors and physical activity, are the ones that we need to really work on if we're going to try to make some impact into this. And the reason why we want an impact is that the long-term complications of gestational diabetes are to the mother as well as to the offspring. In the offspring, they have an increased risk of obesity, insulin resistance, and type 2 diabetes, the offspring. And that's what we call the transgenerational complications of the gestational diabetes. But the mother also has increased risk of type 2 diabetes in later life, and that's going to be also, I'm saving that for the last part of the presentation. But this sort of intergenerational, transgenerational cycle of overweight obesity is something that we've been working on, and many other persons. And it's not just diabetes alone, obesity. So if you have an obese woman, or a woman with insulin resistance, or a woman with diabetes beforehand, generally signifying an issue with nutrition. And nutrition can either lead to a low birth weight child because of intrauterine growth retardation, or a high birth weight child like what we already discussed. These children track to become overweight, obese individuals as adults. They develop the metabolic syndrome, and then they recapitulate the whole cycle. So they're not just treating the woman, they over here, right? They're also treating the next generation of individuals from developing metabolic syndrome and fueling the epidemic. And part of this reason is that when you have this dysmetabolism of hyperglycemia and oxidative stress and inflammation, the stem cells are altered in the offspring. And what you'll do is that you're going to upregulate JNK, what some people call junk, and NF-kappa B, and that's going to lead to decreased muscle synthesis and increased fat mass synthesis. And that is what's going to track with that individual throughout the rest of their life after birth. Now, gestational weight gain is also an influence, because women who have faster gestational weight gain, they become more obese, they have children who are more likely to become obese as well as diabetic. And women with excessive gestational weight gain have up to a 40% increased risk of their offspring becoming obese and diabetic in later life. And that's one of the reasons why now, when I was a medical student, they just told me every woman should gain 12 and a half kilograms, right, or 25 pounds. But now we're saying is, where is the woman starting from? Is she starting already being obese? And if she is, the amount of weight gain that she should have should be less than that 12.5 kilograms, which is different than a woman who is underweight. And that is something that also needs to be popularized, because a lot of people are still thinking of this 25-pound, 12.5 kilogram weight loss. Now, how can we prevent gestational diabetes? And unfortunately, interventions have not generally been successful. And many of these randomized control interventions to try to reduce gestational weight gain have not been successful. There are some ongoing trials with vitamin D, fish oil, and metformin, and we're still waiting for some of those data to come out. And there's also a probiotic study which has not been reported as yet. But more and more, we're turning not from treating women during pregnancy. We want to treat these women, identify them beforehand, and treat them pre-conception or in between pregnancies. Because by the time you catch up them, as Leslie told us already, when they're already pregnant, the barnyard might already be open. Now, how do we define the gestational diabetes? And this is where we get into a lot of controversy. And I'm sure Leslie and I might have some debate afterwards. Because the issue that we have is that it is a continuum of effect. And the HAPO study, which has bearing to us, because in the HAPO trial, a multinational trial, actually has Caribbean women in there. We have 2,000 Barbadian women in this study. So it has some reflection on Caribbean data also. And as you can see, there's no threshold effect. It's a continuum. As the blood sugar rises over, even within the sort of normal range, the risk for the pregnancy also goes up. Now, this has led to a debate about what is the right screening criteria. The WHO had one criteria where they use a 2 hours postprandial glucose of 7.8. The IADBSG criteria are a little bit different, and I'll show you in a little while, and ACOG has one, and you know, we have a lot of different things, and there's a lot of talk about how can we make it more uniform. But the one thing I would like to say about, regardless of whichever one you're using, is that screening should be occurring. And I think, unfortunately, we have too much opportunistic screening now. And in many places where you have a 5% rate of pre-gestational diseases, you may have universal screening. But not all places practice universal screening. Now, for those who are interested, this is the IADPSG criteria, a fasting of 5.1, a 1 hour of 10 after a 70 gram glucose tolerance test, or a 2 hour of 8.5. And if you use this criteria worldwide, about 18% of pregnant women will be diabetic. Worldwide, that will be the rates. There's a little bit of debate because in countries where they're what they call minorities. But it's not minorities, because if you're in India, an Indian is the majority. But if you look at, and same thing also here in Jamaica, when you look at the different ways of identifying diabetes, you capture the vast majority of them. However, the IDPSG is going to identify a few others. The WHO 7.8 criteria, a few certain others. So you might miss a few. In Southeast Asia, they tend to use the 7.8 criteria. But there's variety, and some use an O'Sullivan's criteria. I just want to know that you use something. Use something, anything. Now, if that woman is monitoring, and she, because as was said before, she has to be involved, when should you intervene? She has gestational diabetes, should you add on medication, etc.? And these are some of the criteria that many persons will use. Should you use if the fast is more than 5.3, a 1 hour of 7.2, or a 2 hour of 6.7, certain places are going to consider adding insulin to the regimen. There's a debate whether you should use a 1 hour or a 2 hour value. I like the 1 hour value, but I don't know, Leslie, what you like. You like the 1 hour, right, yeah. So, and there was one study whereby the 1 hour value, if you were to use that, there's less large for gestational age children, as well as there's, whoops, it's not up there. Yeah, there it is. As well as there's less cesarean sections are associated with it. But again, it's just a matter of monitoring. Persons have asked, should we be using new technologies like continuous glucose monitoring systems? And the data so far have shown it might be useful in the type 1 person, but not so much in the gestational diabetic person. But one of the big controversies is, should we use oral agents? And here's one of the earliest studies where clopropamide and tolbutamine was promoted. And one of the first places promoted was South Africa. I think this study is back, I think, 1957. As a matter of fact, this one is over here now for Professor Morrison, because the UHWI weighed on this issue because Ralph Richards published his experience utilizing clopropamide to treat diabetes in the early 1960s. And he promoted using clopropamide. Until a little later, same place at UWI, they said there might be issues that exist when you're using clopropamide, and therefore it should not be utilized in pregnancy. But there's always been this dream that we could still use oral therapy. It's easier, it's cheaper, and it offers other benefits potentially. And there's been a lot of talk about using glyburide in persons, because in animal studies, glyburide doesn't cross the placenta. When they use transplacental studies, with human placenta, it also does not seem to cross the placenta. And especially in New York, they promote a lot of glyburide. And the question is it as effective as using insulin, or do you cause fetal hypoglycemia like what you see with chlorpropamide? So, or is it teratogenic? And there have been several studies that have looked at it, and they seem to show that there's some equivalency between glyburide and insulin in persons who use, or in persons who have gestational diabetes. However, there are some limitations. It's an unblinded study or studies. The power of the agents, I mean, the power of the study was not really powered for teratogenicity. So not all investigators are gung-ho about it. But metformin, as was said before, seems to be good, especially in women who may have had PCOS and have been having first-term trimester spontaneous abortions. And as far as we know, it does not have much, if any, teratogenic effect, and so it's classified as a Class B drug. So I think this now comes to, I think, what Marshall Tullerido was asking, which insulin is best to use if you're going to use insulin? And I use this quote that I don't remember who said it. Insulin was given by God, but insulin analogs are given by pharmaceutical companies, right? Because regular insulin was really at one stage the only insulin approved in pregnancy. Now, that it had category B in more recent times, Lispro, which you may know as Humalog, and aspartate, which you may know as Novorapid, also have Class B status. We can use basal insulin twice per day. There's a thought about, can we use glargine? Although there was the theoretical concern that it might be a bit more mitogenic than regular insulin, but many case series regarded, not great evidence, but case series of persons who are utilizing glargine and have had successful pregnancies. And I've also co-managed several women who are on glargine, more the type 1 person, and they've done beautifully. The take home was that they took home the baby with them. So that is good. And 1 hour PPs or 1 hour postprandials may be important, and if you believe so, then the rapid acting insulin analogs are the ones that actually give you that option to get it more easily. So there are different ways, and we're not going to talk about insulin per se because it's a huge amount, but we can use twice daily split mix regimens where we use NPH and regular twice daily. Just a reminder that as the pregnancy advances, you need to use more insulin. So you have to, it's a moving target. And especially if the person had pre-existing diabetes, such as type 1, utilizing small dosages more frequently gives you better control and less complications in a neonatal person. And to show you, here is one of my patients. You're not sure if you can see it. I just saw her just 2 days ago. This woman is pregnant, and look at this meticulous detail. I didn't put this in an Excel spreadsheet, you know. She did this, right? And she puts down her fastings, her insulin, her 1 hour, her 2 hour, and she gets an average in the last column of about between 5 and 6 for her blood glucose levels. Do you know what her A1C is? 5.0%, right? She's not going to give these guys any trouble if every woman could be like this. Now, the peripartum management, as was heard before, delivery at 38 weeks. They may require a glucose infusion during the delivery process. You may need to give some insulin if her sugars are getting higher. And as you see here, breastfeeding and calories between 25 to 27 kilocalories per kilogram today in the postpartum period is important. Please don't get them into this eating for two business, right? A sure way for them to get obese. Now, the very last part I would just like to say boils down to what I'm more, or part of what I'm very concerned about, that the postpartum rates of diabetes are very, very high. We need to prevent postpartum diabetes. This woman has shown you her hand. She told you, I would love to become diabetic. And you don't believe her? So when she gets pregnant, or when she delivers a baby, she kind of goes off and nothing happens? Or after a year, she forgets about it? No, she has shown you her face. She's shown you her hand. She wants to become pregnant. I mean, not pregnant, diabetic, right? Now, the DPP, the Diabetes Prevention Program, shows you some of the rates of persons developing diabetes. So they've shown the rates for women who had a history of gestational diabetes versus rates of women who are not just who did not have a history of gestational diabetes. And look at that, at year three, 40% of the women who had gestational diabetes in the past developed diabetes. That tells you that gestational diabetes is probably the strongest risk factor you can think about for the development of diabetes. 40% within 3 years in a multi-ethnic population, that's very high. Now, those of us who are endocrinologists, right, and we kind of look at things in a little more, you know, in our own specialty. If you were to risk stratify them differently, in other words, if you were to measure their antibodies against the beta cell, if you were to look at their BMI and whether or not they're on diet, look at the top slide. Sorry, the top dark one, I think, if I can have it right here, this one. If that woman who had gestational diabetes also had antibodies positive, 100% conversion to diabetes over time, 100%. The next line are people who are antibody negative, but they required insulin in their control, right? At, you know, 80%. Persons who have antibody negative but are obese and on diet, you can see anywhere from 50 to 60%. And those who are lean and only use diet, 14%. Right? So there's a differential that exists there. However, if that woman, after delivering, has either intensive lifestyle therapy or exposure to metformin, those rates are dropped by about 40%. Another study has shown an agent called troglitazone, which we no longer have on market, but we have its sister drug, pioglitazone. And pioglitazone and troglitazone actually can help to normalize the rates of hyperglycemia postpartum, and it results in an 86% reduction in the development of diabetes. So that's one of the best that we know. And for the cardiologists in the audience, it is not just also preventing postpartum diabetes. The gestational diabetic woman is also telling you she would love to have heart disease. A study last month showed this. Women with gestational diabetes, even if they never develop postpartum diabetes, have higher rates of cardiovascular disease. So we have work to do. So in summary, glucose is very teratogenic. I think first speaker and I were telling you that. There's a debate on how best to screen, but forget about the debate. Screen. And I'm a proponent of universal screening in our high-risk Jamaican population. There's a debate on the use of oral agents, but we're not going to get into that. You can use insulin, and insulin analogs are increasingly being used. Just get the sugars down. Preprandial monitoring and postprandial monitoring is essential. And screening and intervention is needed in these women after they have been diagnosed with their diabetes. So please, don't let them just get in love with the baby and forget about their health. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mikey. I've been advised by the organizers that we don't have time for any questions for Professor Boyne. I'm very, very sorry about that, but I'm sure he won't mind if you tackle him outside after the session. I want to thank you all for being so patient and being so engaged. I'd also like to thank on your behalf our speakers who I thought gave a good presentation, each one. Please join me in just applauding them for a brilliant presentation. Thank you.